1978, President Jimmy Carter signed the Boundary Waters Canoe Area Wilderness Act into law, prohibiting harmful activities such as mining in the Boundary Waters. This act influenced the mining industry of northern Minnesota as well as protected the dignity of the Boundary Waters, which is backed by environmentalists and should not be violated in the way that future plans of mining companies such as Polymet potentially could. It is our responsibility to protect the Boundary Waters because they are among the few areas of undeveloped land remaining in the country, which every single one of us has the right to admire. In order to understand the significance of the Boundary Waters, one must first know the natural history of it. During the last glacial period, massive glaciers carved and shaped the land that we now know as the Boundary Waters. These glaciers then melted and filled the lowland with water, which turned into the lakes that currently make up the Boundary Waters. The Boundary Waters Canoe Area Wilderness was home to the Ojibwe and Sioux tribes of Native Americans for thousands of years. In the 1730s, the fur trade flourished in the Boundary Waters Canoe Area, which marked the first commercial use of the Boundary Waters area. In 1926, the United States Forest Service ensured that the area would be protected from mining, logging, and other environmentally harmful activities. In 1964, the Wilderness Act, signed into law by Lyndon B. Johnson, included the Boundary Waters Canoe Area Wilderness as part of a nationally protected area that is part of 9 million acres of United States federal land. To realize why the issue of mining in the Boundary Waters Canoe Area Wilderness is not a black and white issue, one must see the role mining has had in the area. Well before Europeans began mining in the United States, Native Americans had been digging for rocks and minerals to create things such as arrowheads, knives, clays, and paints. Since then, mining technology has progressed greatly. Currently, mining happens all over the world and is a primary source of energy for our world. Many of the natural resources that are used in everyday objects are acquired from mining. Northern Minnesota is packed with natural metals that have been mined since the 1880s. The world-famous Iron Range of Minnesota stretches 100 miles from Grand Rapids to Babbitt, Minnesota, and for decades was the world's primary source of iron. Since then, Minnesota has been mined in different areas, but not with as much vigor as in the past. Most recently, a mining company named Polymet has proposed to mine in areas 20 miles south of the Boundary Waters Canoe Area, which is just north of Hoyt Lakes. The chance of jobs for Minnesotans and more revenue for the economy of northern Minnesota could help in several ways, ranging from improved infrastructure to lessen poverty rates. Polymet has proposed about 300 jobs for the next 20 years.
The growth in jobs would mean more families coming in, maybe businesses would come in. I think it would just be a ripple effect of prosperity for our region.
However, the threat of pollution is very real, and the costs of this project will most likely not outweigh the benefits which are proposed. The reason that the threat of pollution is very real is that the mining that Polymet does is a new form of mining that has just surfaced recently. It is called sulfide mining. It uses chemicals to extract metal from sulfide ores. Metals like copper, nickel, and palladium. These metals are used in many household items such as pipes and cell phones. The issue with sulfide mining is that when precipitation comes in contact with sulfide ore waste, sulfuric acid is produced, which leads to polluted water and harm to wildlife. The effects of sulfide waste runoff can continue to occur even well after a mine is closed, yielding long-term environmental effects. The demand for these metals is high, and the potential profit from this mining project is high as well. However, the danger of the environmental destruction that could result from sulfide mining is even higher. Currently, the Department of Natural Resources, also known as the DNR, has been communicating with Polymet in an attempt to form a compromise that would allow Polymet to mine in a safe way that would not harm the wildlife around the mining site. Many skeptics claim that there is no possible way to accommodate for sulfide mining without harming the wildlife around the site, and the damage could cause problems for the next 500 years. In January, we had the chance to visit a public forum hosted by the Department of Natural Resources regarding the plans Polymet has proposed. Of the people that we spoke to at the forum, each one had their own strong opinions.
But anyway, I made it. Do you support copper sulfide mining? Why or why not?
No, I do not.
I do not.
I do not.
No, I do not.
I do not. I don't support it.
I do not.
I'm opposed to it.
No, I don't. Just due to the long-term environmental impacts that will have on northern Minnesota.
No mine in the world has ever operated and closed without polluting surrounding surface waters. And the pollution is not just a short-term thing. What we'd be getting with this mine is 20 years, maybe 20 years of jobs, and about 20 generations worth of toxic cleanup. And that's a bad deal for Minnesota.
I don't think there's any way they can assure that they'll be able to clean that site for longer than the state has been around, much less twice as long as the country's been around.
I teach history at the University of Minnesota. 500 years is a long time. 500 years ago was only about 22 years after Christopher Columbus arrived on these shores. We can't think that far ahead.
Most of the people that are involved with PolyMet just got done doing the same thing in Michigan. They got a mine up and operating in Michigan. It isn't up and operating yet, and they sold it in January of 2013. So they're not in it for the long haul. They're in it for the quick dollar.
The area in northern Minnesota has a long history of mining. They've never had a copper sulfide mine. These people walking around here with these "we support mining" stickers, they have no idea what they're supporting. It's like somebody who says, "I'm in favor of the Second Amendment, the right to bear arms," not realizing that people are going to walk into schools and kill school children. They have no idea.
So do you support the copper sulfide mining in Minnesota? Why or why not?
I support jobs in Minnesota, but clean jobs.
I do support it.
I support it.
I do support copper sulfide mining.
Absolutely.
Yes, I do, as long as it's done responsibly.
I do support copper mining in the state of Minnesota, and the reason I do is because I trust the DNR and the other parties that are involved in assessing this situation. I believe they're going to do it the right way, and they're going to make sure the PolyMet does it the right way.
I'm from Tower, Minnesota. I live about 20 miles from the LTV site. I graduated from the Tower High School. It was one of the last classes to graduate from the Tower High School. It closed down. Our school district's failing. We don't have enough money. People are moving the area. We have a net discharge of people. There's people coming into Minnesota, but they're not coming into the Iron Range. So this mine would be a shot in the arm to our region.
I support mining in Minnesota for jobs.
Copper is a global resource. If it doesn't come from Minnesota, it's going to come from Africa or China. They have terrible environmental standards. Minnesota has some of the best environmental standards in the world. So if we're going to mine copper one way or another, why not do it here?
In order to get an expert opinion on the issues concerning mining in the Boundary Waters, we conducted an interview with the managing editor of the Minnesota Conservation Volunteer magazine, Keith Getzman.
How much do you know about the sulfide mining, and how do you feel about it?
Well, I feel I know quite a bit about the proposed mining in northern Minnesota because our magazine has published a couple stories relating to it. Mm-hmm. On this issue, I'm speaking for myself and not as a representative of the DNR. This is my personal opinion. I don't, at this time, think that it's worth it because I don't think the costs have been fully evaluated and identified. There's a lot that could go wrong with the plan they have for containing the polluted runoff from the mine, and there will be polluted runoff from the mine. Yeah. There's no doubt about that. This debate is about what will be done with it. Mm-hmm. So it's certain to pollute. Now, I think it's worth noting that the mine that's currently proposed is not in the Boundary Waters, and it's not in the Boundary Waters watershed. However, PolyMet, the mining company that wants to open this mine, has future expansion plans that are in the Boundary Waters watershed.
What do you love being up in the Boundary Waters? What's the best part of it for you?
It's an unmatched sort of landscape. You don't realize how rare it is until you go elsewhere and you think you might find a Boundary Waters type place, and you know what? There's nothing exactly quite like it.